All right, good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Thanks for coming. My name is Carson Newberry. I've been with Siemens for about 18 years. For those that don't know me, I'm part of the Siemens PLM executive management team, and Femap is one of the great products that falls under my responsibility. Although I must say that we've got such a great team that I don't have to worry about this at all. All right, I'll speak up a little bit. I don't have to worry about it at all because Mark really runs the business with the team. So this is always a very special event because I always feel that the Femap customers and our team are so close together. So I think there's a great opportunity here. We have really a team here that can influence the product, the strategy, and what we do for you as customers. So hopefully you'll have a great day today. I'll turn it over to Mark and let him run the show, all right? So I hope you all have a great day.
Thank you, Carson. All right, I guess you heard I'm Mark Sherman. I've been with Femap since there was two of us in George's basement of his house, so I've been there forever. I always tell people I've done everything. I do programming, and in our first office, I got to clean the toilets since he was the big boss. So it's been a long time I've been there. One thing I do want to say, if you ever need to get a hold of me, if I can get an edit in here. I'm backwards on the email. There's another Mark Sherman at Siemens. I must get a lot of my emails. But if you ever have a Femap issue and you need help, I'm available. I'd be glad to help you out. Just email me there. I do want to point out, I got a bunch of people from the Femap team here. So there's guys here, and I'll be pointing them out during the day, and we get to a particular topic that's their area of expertise. But can you guys stand up so everyone can see you? I got Joe Bracken. Joe's quite the Nastran expert. If you got some really technical Nastran questions, he's your guy to talk to. I got two of my programmers back there, Patrick Consieri and Dan Hinkle. And when I hit some of the stuff they've done and the what's new and what we're doing, I'll tell you exactly what these guys have been programming. And if you got some suggestions or things you'd like them to, you know, incorporate in the software, they're the guys that you could probably leverage with a beer down the bar after the thing today. Who else we got here? Chip. We got Chip Fricke here. Chip's one of my applications engineers, does a lot of our training materials, stuff like that. Questions about using the software, Chip's one of the guys you can talk to. We do have a hands-on room. It's down right side, the end of this hallway, one of the rooms there. We're gonna set up, one of our guys will be down there all day. We'll have a machine set up. If you feel like bouncing out of a session for a minute and just coming in and asking some individual Femap questions, or maybe you got some model you're having trouble with or something you wanna understand better, we'll have one of our guys down there. You can sit down and do a little one-on-one session and kinda do that. We do want to talk about some of our successes. These are some of our big customers, and in particular kind of ties into our keynote speech today. Just wanted to mention down in Chile, we've got these ground-based radio telescopes. All the analysis work on those were done with Femap. Again, on kind of the ground-based telescope side, we got ADS International's been using Femap to design these adaptive optic mirrors, and I imagine there's a lot of dynamics and stability and stuff in there. And kind of keying into the keynotes here at the Femap Symposium, last year's keynote was on the Mars rover, and we still got some nice success stories, and there's some pretty cool videos out there of how that works from an engineering standpoint, but that was a Femap project. All the statics and dynamic analysis was done using Femap at JPL. And this year our keynote will be the James Webb Space Telescope, NASA Goddard Space Flight Center project. And I always love NASA Goddard. When George and I were in his basement, NASA Goddard was one of our first customers. They used to call up every 2 months and order another two seats of Femap like clockwork. So we've been in a long-term cooperation with NASA Goddard. I'd like to thank our sponsors for the symposium. These are the guys that help pay the bills around here. And we probably should have told you there was a continental breakfast this morning down there at the same place we had the reception last night. I don't think anybody knew about it, but tomorrow morning, if you want to stop in there, you know, grab a muffin and a coffee and all that stuff, that'll be set up again. It is the same place we'll be having lunch today, so you go all the way down to the end of the hallway and hang a right, but our friends at Applied CAX, SDC Verify, and Maya, our premium sponsors, and Pro Lambda also chipped in on paying the bills here, so thank you guys for doing that. The agenda is pretty straightforward. Most of the things will be happening in this room. So the main present, not the main presentations, but the kind of the continuous track there on the left-hand side will all be taken right here in this room. We got a couple other presentations. You might want to look at your agenda, decide on some of these, which one you want to head over to. But that'll be in the room right next door, kind of behind all you guys right now. So if you want to go over to one of those. And then tomorrow morning, we're all back in here for the whole time. We'll do some presentations in the morning. And then we do our kind of what would you like to see in FEMAP session, where we kind of collect requests from customers, you guys, what you'd like us to add to the software. And I think actually from the stuff we collected last year, we did do a pretty good job of getting things into the software. We like to hear feedback about the event, make sure we're doing things right. So you'll notice in your packet, there is a feedback form. If you fill that out and you turn it in up at the registration desk, they will give you a lovely flash drive that you've probably already got 50 of them anyway. We are promoting our FEMAP community site. There's several places on the internet you can go to right now, and there's FEMAP groups on the engineering tips. There's one on Yahoo. And we try to monitor all those, but it'd be better for us and probably better for you if we consolidated all the FEMAP question and answer activity to one location. So Siemens now sponsors a site, and I can never remember the web address, so I just go to Google and type in FEMAP community, and it's the first thing it takes you to. But if you go in there, you can sign up. My guys are monitoring this, so people are asking questions there, we're answering questions there. We're actually posting APIs there, so we write some type of program that helps somebody out. We post it to the My Community site, so it's kind of a central repository where we can keep in touch and at least monitor it as actively as we can. Has anyone gone there yet? It's been working pretty well. Al, do we do a copy of all this? Yeah, with this all, everything from last year went up online, yeah. Yeah. There's also, just to let everyone know, this doesn't apply in the US, but internationally there's a new buying option for FEMAP. There's actually a monthly subscription option where you can actually go online, you sign up, you put your credit card in, you pay a monthly fee. At the end of the month, you can do recurring billing, where just at the end of every 30 days, it charges you again, and you get another license file, gets automatically downloaded, and you keep rolling. But it's a good way for people, short-term use of FEMAP. We're also telling people, if you're getting ready to shell out $35,000 on ANSYS, maybe you want to do this for a month or two and see if you like FEMAP better before you spend all that money. So it's kind of just a more flexible way of buying it, and it's already up and running, and sales are happening over in Europe, so it's there. It automatically hooks you into a support partner, so it's the system's kind of automated. It's pretty nice, and you download, and you're up and running right away. So it's just a new way. We're going to look at distributing the software. Probably doesn't affect us a lot here in the U.S. right now. People always ask, how's FEMAP doing? What's its future? This is kind of our worldwide footprint, our customer base. It continues to go up. So we're having the economic downturn kind of slammed us all there for a while, where people stopped paying their maintenance, and I guess a lot of those guys came back when the money came back. So FEMAP continues to grow in all regions across the world. We have more and more customers, and you'll see from the success stories and things that some pretty fascinating work being done with FEMAP. So the business is doing well. We're still programming away like mad, so FEMAP's going to be there. We kind of run through, we did this last year. This is just kind of our biggest customers over the past year. So you'll see a kind of a cross the board, kind of pretty heavily aerospace from shipbuilding. We're going to welcome Embraer back in the fold. They were an MSC Nastran for Windows customer years and years ago, and they've been coming back and buying seats and moving over to Siemens now and NX Nastran. So welcoming them back. But SpaceX, big customer. So a lot of these names you'll recognize. And these are people that have been with us for a long time. They continue to stick with us. Some of the same names from the previous one, but Orbital Sciences there, Harris Corporation. These are all guys that kind of came in about the same time as NASA Goddard. They've been with us since the 90s, so it's been a fantastic long-term relationship.
Hey, Mark, just ask about the presentations. The drive that you mentioned,
oh, they're going to be right on there? Okay, so guys, fill out that survey. When you hand it in, you can get the presentations, take them home right with you right away if you don't feel like waiting for them to get posted to the web, which probably wouldn't take that long anyway. We're doing it right on time here. Yeah, 5 minutes early. Let me run the movie first, right? I got to organize this year. I put everything in one directory so I can find it.
Construction is the premier telescope of the next decade. A next-generation space telescope designed to cause yet another giant leap forward in our understanding of the cosmos. It will carry some of the most advanced technologies ever placed on an orbiting observatory.
Articulating mirror segments, 2.75 times the diameter of Hubble's primary mirror. Microshutters, wavefront sensing and control subsystem, 12 by 18 meter, 5-layer captain-based sunshield.
The Webb Telescope, a revolutionary tool able to study every phase in the history of our universe.
The Webb Telescope.
I think every engineer should get to come on to a presentation like that at least once in their career. God bless the outreach budget for NASA.
Right, representing SGT in the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, Mark McGinnis, and also Dr. Emmanuel, Cofie.
Thanks for having us. Emmanuel and I were finalizing the prep for this presentation, and this picture was actually selected by the Femap Symposium people, and it's a fabulous picture, don't get me wrong. Perhaps the coolest engineering picture ever. But we were also reminding ourselves that that's really impressive, and there's no scale tricks there. That's the guy standing right in front of the mirrors, except that that's one third of the telescope. That you basically flip it on the horizontal axis and add three mirrors on each side. So it's rather big, and just about everything about this project impresses people on it, especially as they join it. So as the dramatic video said, it's a 6.5 meter primary mirror, giving us roughly four times the collecting area of the Hubble Space Telescope. And the project is managed out of Goddard. Our prime contractor is Northrop Grumman Aerospace Systems in Space Park, Los Angeles. They have a large number of primes, the two most important being ATK's Magna Utah Composites Group and the Ball Aerospace Technology Corporation out of Boulder. They have some others, of course, but those are the two, by value, the two largest. As was in the video, the objective here is that JWST observe basically the first luminous glows after the Big Bang and formation of solar systems and the evolution of our own solar system. It was not specifically sold or targeted as a planet-finding telescope. That isn't to say that they'll never attempt to use it for that purpose, but the primary science requirements were not targeted towards that. Then the important thing about these requirements in terms of glows after the Big Bang and formation of solar systems is the scientists have decided what level of sensitivity they need to see these events according to their models, and those have been flowed down into all of our engineering requirements. We always are Anytime we have to make a tough engineering decision, there's a scientist in the room who's helping say, either directly or by going back to his peers, that will or will not compromise our ability to do the science we want to do. And we are always reminded that that's ultimately our real customer is the science community. Four science instruments on board. All of them are in the infrared. The NIRCam being made at the University of Arizona, which is a straight near-infrared camera. NIRSpec, near-infrared spectrometer being built by ESA, although Goddard has provided a micro-shutter array, essentially well over 1,000 tiny MEMS shutters that are addressable so that portions, the portion of the light beam going into that instrument can be even more selected so that they can do spectroscopy on specific targets. The mid-infrared instrument, also an ESA and JPL instrument, which is actually the coldest instrument, it's actively cooled. And the fine guide sensor, near-infrared imager, and slitless spectrograph. They've recently changed the name on that one, so we all have to learn it now. NIRSIS. That's actually being made by the Canadian Space Agency, and it's dual purpose. It's in addition to being a legitimate near-infrared science instrument in its own right, it's also used to actively track the spot as it enters the telescope and act as a fine guide sensor to provide additional stability in two axes. SGT is, our SGT's role in all of this is that we provide engineers to NASA, Goddard. We provide engineers to many other NASA centers as well, but in Dr. Cofie and myself work at the Goddard Space Flight Center. We're embedded in the mission system engineering team, in my case, or in the ISIM instrument team, which is a distinct group at Goddard, in Dr. Cofie's case. And there are five or six other members of my group who work on that in that capacity, in addition to a large number of people from SGT working in contamination control, other systems, full regular systems engineering, as opposed to analysis, and in a number of other areas. I would forget them all if I tried to name them. We're in our seventh year as a valuable partner to Goddard, and most of us have worked in the community far longer than 7 years. We just did it for a different employer in the past. So the way James Webb will be able to attain the level of stability and sensitivity that it needs to achieve its science objectives is that it can't be in Earth orbit. It will be headed to L2 orbit, which is to say about 1.5 million kilometers beyond Earth, away from the sun, of course, so that the sun shield will block not just the sun, but also the Earth and the moon in almost every case. There's some extreme positions in the orbit where you might see a bit of moon. But to get there, it has to be stowed and folded up inside of the Ariane launch vehicle. As you can see, there's a great deal of folding going on. You have structure folded up here, and there's a similar structure here. Some of the primary mirror is actually folded basically at right angles to its use position. The secondary mirror is stowed is up here, and it will flip out to here. And of course, there's other deployments that are there's solar array deployment, etc. So I described it recently as the world's most elaborate origami project. The main parts of James Webb are basically that the basic way to think of James Webb is to think of it as having two halves. The optical telescope element is the cold half where the science is done. It contains the primary mirror, 18 segments each, about a little over a meter flat to flat, and a secondary mirror, which is roughly the same size as a single primary segment, but it's convex and the light is still converging when it comes off of it. And it actually goes into two mirrors contained in what is very small here, the aft optic structure. And that sends the light back forward onto the fine guide sensor mirror, and then that commanded mirror sends it back into the four science instruments. All of that is kept very cold by this sun shield, which when deployed, by law I'm required to say, is the size of a tennis court. It's five, essentially five layers of Kapton. that deploy. Each is converging, they're diverging away from the spacecraft bus so that all the energy keeps flowing out. Each one basically knocks down the incident energy onto the telescope by about a factor of 10, allowing the energy that makes it to the cold side and is dissipated by the radiators that are on the back side of the optical telescope element. They're essentially dissipating the heat of about one Christmas tree light. And so there's very low energy on the cold side, as you would have to be, as the operating temperatures are in tens of degrees Kelvin and the instruments themselves are in single digits Kelvin. Those instruments are inside the ISIM. You can sort of see it here. Unfortunately, Emmanuel's excellent work on the ISIM is all buried deep in the telescope and no one will ever see it. Hopefully we'll see the good products that come out of it. On the hot side of the telescope, we've got the sunshade itself acting as the primary radiation block. And then there's a bus, the spacecraft bus here is itself several meters across, has a large solar array, obviously has to have a high gain antenna pointing back to Earth, and there are three star trackers located here to allow us to do coarse object acquisition, get us looking in the right general area of space for the fine guide sensor to lock on to the target and to provide stability. Because with the fine guide sensor, there's nothing to stop the telescope from rolling about its optical axis other than observations from the star trackers. There's also a trim flap back here. The purpose of that is to balance the solar pressure on the sunshade to minimize the amount of time we have to fire the rockets to keep our orientation acceptable. Femap's role on JWST is basically categorized into three areas. There's traditional loads modeling, which is to say the sorts of launch load reactions that we all have to deal with, or environmental roads. The design and testing of the ISIM was very actively involved in that area, as that emission was entirely Goddard-based. And finally, the on-orbit stability, thermal distortion and jitter, which is illustrated by the flapping mirrors. You'll see more of those later. Before I go on, I want to say a word about NASA and NASTRAN and our trust in it, which is to say that we really don't, no model coming fresh out of Femap is trusted by a NASA Goddard. NASA was involved in the creation, actually the group I started in as a civil servant was involved in the creation of NASTRAN, and we know it's a valuable tool, but we also know that it has its limitations, and you can make a bad model that runs and gives you answers, but the problem is you can't believe they're necessarily good answers. So every model that's used on James Webb, and we encourage every model, full stop, to go through a series of checks to prove that it's free of grounding and that the rigid body motion is free without any constraint, that there's no mechanisms that you don't expect, and that the rigid and flexible modes are adequately separated, and that you have free thermal expansion if you're going to use it for any sort of thermal distortion calculation. These checks build our confidence in the model, and once we've completed them successfully, we view the model as ready to go for other purposes. And Femap is, of course, an integral part of preparing and running and examining these checks. And I strongly encourage, the checks themselves are documented at the URL that's below, and it's open to anybody anywhere in the world, and we encourage its use. Now that I've gotten in our plug for the validity checks, we'll talk about the ISIM structure. This is Emmanuel's main area of activity over the last 10 years. So it's GSFC is building the ISIM as a subassembly going into James Webb. It houses the four science instruments I spoke of earlier, operating at roughly 40K, stable to about 1 degree Kelvin over all operating conditions. Obviously not during launch, but once we're on orbit and deploy the sunshield, we expect it to change temperature by less than a degree. And as you can see, it's large, a little over 2 meters by 2.3, and fully populated, not this structure, but fully populated, it's weighing in at 860 kilograms. The structure you see here is mainly composite tubes with a liberal use of metallic fittings at the various joints. It's not truly a truss structure in that sense. There are moments transferred across the joints. This structure has been built and been through all of its proof testing. I'll talk a little bit about that later. And we've fully populated it with all the science instruments, which have all arrived at Goddard now. This picture is from the SysDiff, as we call it at Goddard, the world's largest class 10,000 clean room. As I was saying earlier, it's not a computer level clean room, but it's more targeted more towards keeping optics and detectors clean, free of contaminant, so that they function most effectively. The ISIM has completed two of its cryogenic proof tests and one full system operational test. It's going in for a second operational test in June. They just had their pre-environmental review last week, successfully completed that, and they'll be going back into the cryovac chamber before the end of next month to basically illuminate all the science instruments, make sure that it's functioning as expected before they integrate it into the James Webb proper. The way ISIMs has successfully gotten where they've gotten is by using very much of a stepping stone approach. They started by checking materials, doing material level testing, then small assembly level testing, and then large assembly level testing before they ever built the full ISIM structure. The materials, they were looking for modulus and CTE, making sure they understood the layups they planned to use fairly well and have a nominal set of properties that they would then carry forward. These properties were then integrated into more and more elaborate assemblies, which representing the various joints that they planned to use in the full ISIM structure. And then they built a large assembly, which we'll see later, proving that basically the whole is the sum of its parts, that they achieved acceptable accuracy. And then finally, the full ISIM structure model, which, as I said, has been successfully built and tested. And now a little bit more step by step on what that looked like. They started with, as I said, once they had the material properties that they wanted to use, they created what they knew to be a detailed enough stress model of a simple tube with two metallic fittings. Metallic fittings down here on either end. This is a composite tube, and there you can see the white speckling going on in here. That's an RB3 to basically track this and the average motion of this end of each end of the tube. That model was taken as sort of the gold standard prediction for that material for this particular piece, and then they developed a more and more coarse mesh till they were getting an acceptable level of mesh element, acceptable level of elements in the mesh, without sacrificing accuracy. The objective here was that the prediction from the reduced mesh model would differ by only about 10% relative to the full stress model, and they achieved that, and it gave them a mesh density which, as you can see, is much coarser and allows them to build up a large scale ISIM model, which you clearly, once you started using model, you couldn't do with a full-blown stress model. It would simply get too large, considering it's only one small part of the overall telescope. Femap is a valuable tool when you're modeling with these composite tube elements, because each tube essentially has to have six coordinate systems to allow you to define the isotropic properties properly. And once you've got one tube with the six coordinate systems, then you have to assemble them, and this is the large breadboard, it was called, the large-scale test of all the various types of joints. This is an actual piece of hardware in addition to being a Femap model, but Emmanuel would add a tube to this model and make sure that turn on all the coordinate systems and make sure they were where they needed to be, and then add another one, and through the use of groups and such, he confirmed that he had all the orientations correct so that the properties would be what he expected them to be. So as you can see, with the breadboard of this elaborate level, there was plenty of chances to have a misplaced coordinate system. So the ability to turn off groups and make sure you were looking at only what you needed to be looking at was a valuable part of the Femap toolkit. While this was designed and optimized for successful thermal distortion predictions, ultimately this model actually is useful as well for dynamics. Now, ISIM also made extensive use of Femap in the transition of global to local modeling. This is on the left here, you have a full ISIM model at the coarse mesh density we saw earlier. And this was solved for a cool down case from room temperature to cryo, and forces were extracted at each of the tubes coming into basically every complex joint. This is the one we're highlighting here. Those forces were extracted using an API developed at Goddard for the purpose, and the geometry exported, geometry and forces exported, and then this model was built up at the very high mesh density that allows them to actually track stresses. Those forces applied through the use of RB3 elements at the end of each of the mini tubes coming into this joint. It should be pointed out that this model, which represents the small area here, actually contains more elements than that full model. It allows them to get stresses that are actually believable, and stress margins were low. The stress of cooling down created a great deal of stress between the various parts, and I know that both the ISIM and the backplane fought very low margins in this area, so the stresses had to be accurately predicted. And you built local models for basically, like I say, every one of the complex joints here? Yeah. Okay. And at the JWST level, we also had thermal distortion and deploy dynamics models. Early on, they were built as distinct models. The thermal distortion model is used to predict the thermally induced wavefront error changes. Wavefront error ties back to the science objectives. These models are being used primarily for they're of the telescope and the deployed configuration, and they're being used for stability calculations. This is not about surviving launch loads. In the deployed dynamics model, you're looking at basically jitter sources, mechanical noise within the telescope that gets transmitted into the mirror system and affects the ability to have a stable image. In both cases, we're getting models from the component manufacturers. They are the ones who know the hardware best, so it makes sense that they model the hardware. And Northrop Grumman and Goddard would collaborate on building the full system model. And as I say, early on, there was actually a distinct deployed dynamics versus thermal distortion model. But as the thermal distortion model in its current status is about 5.2 million elements, 27 million DOF, and that does not include a fair number of the parts that we feel really have no effect on the on-orbit stability, such as the spacecraft bus isn't represented at all. As we work today, this model, in its full absurd size, is actually reduced substantially through Craig Bampton reductions and is used for all the dynamics modeling as well. They keep the parts they need to have detail on, but they do a Craig Bampton reduction on all the other parts. And this leads to a large effort in making sure that the Craig Bampton models are not artificially grounded or otherwise compromised. Once we have a set of models to use, we start doing the sorts of predictions that we're paid to do. This is an example of the thermal modeling of the ISIM. It's using the same techniques that we use on the full observatory level thermal modeling. At left we have a thermal model visualized in their software. You can see here, this is the mid-infrared imager telescope, basically the thermal shield that sits around it. These are mass mock-ups of other science instruments. These temperatures are mapped onto the structural model using a Python script. And in this case, like these blue elements of the thermal shielding for the MIRI are just shown as bar elements. You can see that we in the structural model actually have representation of the science instrument itself. The thermal people don't have that representation. It's one of the problems that you always have when you're trying to do stop analysis of going from a thermal to a structural model. We just simply care about different things. So, but we, you know, we use Femap to make sure that what we've done here in this mapping is appropriate. The Femap model is visualized here, and in every case, the thermal engineers who have built this model look at the mapped model and confirm that it's what they want it to be. One other thing. You don't see in this, but each of these instruments has its own purpose-built radiator. And that's how the heat that they generate is dissipated into the heat sink of cold space. Once you've done that mapping, you can actually run a case and calculate your distorted shape of the, in this case, the ISIM. The load case is cooling down from room temperature to its operating temperature. You can see these are the four of the 6 feet that are actually attached to the back of the backplane skeletal structure. And you can also see along these tube walls actually cave in as they cool down. You end up with what's called a butterfly shape of the tubes. And Femap, this is actually a useful thing. It allows you to confirm that each tube is modeled, and acts as another check, that each tube is modeled correctly, because if it doesn't take on that characteristic shape, then you've got a problem in how you've oriented your coordinate systems. This sort of mapping and thermal distortion calculation isn't merely done at the ISIM level. We also do it at the full JWST level. What's shown here is essentially the skeletal structure of JWST. It drives almost all of our deformed shape for thermal distortion stability. Each of the mirrors is basically sitting in one of these hexagonal bays, and the secondary mirror attaches at these 3 points. The case being analyzed here is basically a very conservative worst-case hot-to-cold analysis over 14 days. We assume it's cold-soaked at one corner of the field of regard, which is about 50 degrees in pitch and 10 degrees in roll. It's about the size of the field of regard. So we basically cold-soak it at one corner of that field of regard, and then assume it instantly moves to the other corner of that field of regard and sits there essentially as long as it takes to reach equilibrium. In the case of this temperature progression, that is about 30 plus days, and the temperature change here is comfortably less than 1 degree Kelvin. So it looks very dramatic to say all that heat's coming up from the spacecraft bus is down here, and all this temperature change is propagating out of that area into the backplane, but the net effect is a very, very small change in temperature, thanks to the elaborate design features placed on the telescope to make sure that it does stay that stable. In addition to doing thermal distortion stability calculations, we're doing dynamic stability calculations. This is my favorite mode, the wing flapping mode, we like to call it, as if it's trying to fly. You can get a better feel for the full telescope in this picture. Although you'll notice the sun shield itself is not shown here. These are support structure elements for the sun shield, but the shield itself isn't present. And as you can anticipate, this is just a normal mode of the telescope. It doesn't have any, its magnitude isn't meaningful. But obviously, as these mirrors move back and forth, they're changing the size and shape of the spot on the detector because they're changing the path that the light is, the path along which the light is propagated. So this is one of the modes that we've identified as critical to the performance of the telescope. And this is the other really critical mode in that way. And here you can see each of the mirrors just tipping. They're tip-tilt modes, essentially, of each mirror. The mirrors are structurally very similar, so they all want to resonate at about the same frequency. So you get a large number of them resonating in these, you know, in these shapes, which again will compromise the idea of keeping the spot exactly in the same location on the detector and exactly in the same shape and of the same magnitude if you're looking at the same object. The idea being that we want to be able to go back to an object, not just observe it over one long observation, which can be of order 10,000 seconds, but the ability to go back and look at it up to 2 weeks later. And the way that we do, the way that they're doing jitter analysis on the telescope is they're basically extracting key mode shapes for all the locations of interest, all the mirrors and all the locations of noise sources. Extracting all of that information and providing it to an outside tool, which also has an incorporated a model of the mechanical noise due to mainly the reaction wheels and the active cryogenic pump that's keeping MIRI as cold as it is kept. The net result is that in this external tool, they can then calculate the predicted wavefront error and line of sight error, as shown here. Against the red line is the requirement, and this is line of sight error in two axes, and then this is wavefront error. This happens to be due to the reaction wheels. But all they know is they get a plot like this that says we've got, at these wheel speeds, we're poking through the requirement, and a certain amount of that is acceptable. There's a percentile of requirement. But they know that they're getting these peaks, and they're saying they're partly because of mode 53, or whatever the number of this mode is. And then you go, then Femap is used to go back, open up mode 53, and say, well, this is why it's causing a problem. That allows us to, if there's a mitigation strategy we want to pursue, you can't know what that mitigation strategy is going to be until you go from a plot like this, pick out the troublesome modes, go back and visualize them, and then figure out what you might possibly be able to do to mitigate that particular mode. There was another troublesome mode involving basically swaying of this three-legged support of the secondary mirror. And through that process, they've actually added tune mass dampers to the secondary mirror structure to the point where that mode isn't really a problem anymore. And that's only possible because you can visualize the modes. I like to say that JWST is the biggest project at Goddard, and testing JWST is the second biggest project at Goddard. It's become a major project unto itself because of the challenges involved. As we all know, we're engineers. If there's not a requirement to be met and to be proven through a test, then we're just designers. We can do whatever looks cool, and we don't have to worry about whether it actually works. But generally, especially at Goddard, we have requirements we have to prove we've met. Some of the requirements are more straightforward to prove than others. ISIM, for example, has been through very straightforward. We have to survive this level of inertial loading, and they've done testing which proves that has applied that level of inertial loading, and this has been successfully completed without structure failure. They also have to survive at 30 Kelvin, roughly, and they've taken it to 30 Kelvin and survived that fine. We do have, JWST as a telescope level does have those sorts of requirements. It's going to be on a launch vehicle. We know roughly what the inertial loading, the jitter and sign loading that launch vehicle is going to induce into the structure, and we'll test to that, and I'll talk about that a little bit. But in addition, we have the stability requirements, the jitter and the thermal distortion, that I'll talk about too, present a different set of testing challenges. And that's actually really a lot of the problem is these operational stability requirements. We can't really prove these in a ground test. So we have to prove them by analysis, and we've developed a process to develop that confidence. So as I was saying, ISIM has been through successful strength proof testing. This illustrates solid modeling in preparation for the test, and you'll notice in this case ISIM is oriented differently than it is in the actual photograph of the test. Here's the ISIM model with mass mock-ups of the various instruments attached. And there were a total of, Emmanuel recalls, 8 different tests that were done in this, in the Goddard's large centrifuge. As I say, they do 8 different tests in this interview in various orientations, and the net result is that every structural element gets inertially loaded to the level expected to be seen on orbit. There were components missing, mainly harnessing, and so all the places where that harnessing attached had to be done with a pull test. But this allowed them to basically do all the inertial strength proof testing in a series of 8 tests. Give you a feel for another feel for the scale of this exercise. This, when they're not testing ISIM with this centrifuge, they've actually been used by, this has been used by the Department of Transportation to model rollover on an SUV. So you can comfortably sit an SUV across the end of the structure and apply lateral inertial loading to it. It's a really cool artifact to have. Everybody loves to see the centrifuge. So, as I said, once you've proven the strength requirements of ISIM, you also need to prove the cryo survivability, and in fact, this is illustrating cryo operation. On the left, we have a thermal model. This is a helium shroud cutaway, obviously. This is Goddard's largest cryovac chamber, and this is the thermal model of the ISIM and all of its testing hardware. This cabinet back here is actually the ISIM electronics, correct? Is that still part of? Yeah, the ISIM electronics cabinet, yeah, or whatever they call it. I always call it cabinet. It's probably not the right name. As you can tell, they don't allow me to do real work anymore. They let Emmanuel do the real work, and I just signed his time card. And the cryo test structure. The cryo test structure is the structural model. Emmanuel has taken thermal predictions of this test environment, not the on-orbit environment, mapped it onto the structure and predicted deformations. For the functional test, its instruments have been present and illuminated, and observed values for targets, for observed motion of targets, essentially, has been observed from the test and compared to predictions from Emmanuel's structural model. Emmanuel, can you remind, did you take real temperatures and reapply them after the test?
Yeah.
In addition to pre-test predicted thermal environment, the test correlation is actually done to the observed temperatures, which were similar but not exactly the same. Yeah. And that becomes the functional test for the ISIM. As I say, they're going to do a And this is the sort of result you would see out of that. The blue is basically the photogrammetry observation with the error bar. As you can see, in some cases, the observation is well within the error bar. The sort of red is a stochastic prediction with a margin of error based on a 2-sigma variation in properties such as CTE and modulus. And then the green bar is basically a nominal prediction, which would lie somewhere similar to this location, but it just has a simple 1.6 multiplicative factor on it, or a model uncertainty factor, we call it. And that's used for a lot of our thermal distortion work, basically saying we know there's a lot we don't know, so we scale it by a 1.6. If we do the stochastic, we might reduce that scaling a little bit, but it gives us a margin of error. As I say, once we get, once we integrate ISIM, add the mirror, receive the skeleton, and integrate the mirrors and add the secondary mirror structure, all of which will happen at Goddard, we'll then do environmental testing at that level. We call it the OTIS level because we're NASA and we need acronyms. So to do that, some other members of my group have been supporting an exercise in determining, one, whether the existing vibration test equipment we had at Goddard was sufficiently capable to allow us to do this OTIS level testing. And the initial analysis showed that we were going to need a larger vibration table. And we supported that procurement effort through the use of Femap to visualize, to recover loads, et cetera. And then once we have procured, installed that, and we've built OTIS, which is perhaps the much harder challenge, our engineers will use Femap to model the random and signed vibe testing, allow us to determine where we need to do notching to make sure we don't overstress components, and in general support the test, and then do post-test correlation of the full model. We're required to do cross-orthogonality checks between the observed test mode shapes and the predicted mode shapes in the test configuration. And once this testing is completed, the hardware is then actually shipped to Johnson Space Center for the next round of testing, which I will talk about that, but this is a little bit more about the fact that there are sort of really two telescopes is a way to think about it. This is the stowed telescope, the launch configuration, and that sees the launch loads. This is basically demonstrates an engineering test unit, what we call the Pathfinder. It's a simpler version of the backplane. It doesn't have any of the capability of accommodating ISIM. It doesn't have the wings, but it does have the ability to have a secondary mirror, has a couple of primary mirrors, and there's the ability to accommodate the aft optic structure. This engineering demonstration unit will be used to do some initial dynamics testing. This will happen at Goddard. The cryo damping is fairly well understood, so it's largely about making sure we can do good cross orthogonality on the deployed configuration. And Femap has been used to develop models of this test and other testing. But in order to get to Johnson, it has to be transported. Both this configuration and what's shown here, which is the full telescope configuration, will be transported in the same transporter developed, used to model, to transport it to Johnson, and then on to Los Angeles for final assembly, addition of the bus, the sunshield, et cetera, and then transport to the launch facility. The same transport container built by Nelson Manufacturing. It has a vibration isolation system, so we've worked closely with them in making sure that that's giving us enough attenuation in our expected air, sea, and land loads that the launch loads envelop them. So we don't want the transportation loads driving our design case. So we've modeled this, including the vibration isolation system, in all of its various configurations. This happens to be the full telescope configuration, and including actually putting accelerometers on a ship, the ship that will be used to transport it from Los Angeles to the launch site, we actually equipped that with accelerometers for a transoceanic voyage and made sure that we understood the environment that it would see there. I want to talk a little bit here about the paradigm for how we're going to be able to do thermal distortion stability modeling at Johnson with this article. As I said, we're not ever going to be able to see the level of stability we require for on orbit in a ground test. The gravity sag of the mirrors alone swamps out everything else we would ever be trying to find. So we do have to, we've used modeling to determine a test noise floor, and then we've modeled the test to figure out how much change in, we're always looking for a temperature stability, so it's essentially change in cryogenic temperature is needed to rise above this noise floor. It turns out to be about a factor of 10 in the case of the full telescope testing. There's also this same paradigm has been used for various sub-assembly tests as well. But at the OTIS level, we're going to have to scale up the temperature instability by about a factor of 10 to get above this test noise floor by a comfortable margin. We'll perform the test to this higher change in temperature. It's coming along for free with some optical testing. And then we'll actually take, again, as ISIM did, we'll take the observed temperatures, apply them to a model of the test configuration, and calculate how we compare to the test itself. We'll correlate it to, we'll manipulate the properties where appropriate within predefined bounds to allow us to correlate to the test requirements so that our pass-fail criteria here is that our prediction, including whatever model uncertainty factor we've used, envelops the test result with its uncertainty so that we can be sure that we've predicted at least as well as we need to for our muff to be valid. And then we essentially extract the flight model from the test model configuration and use that to repeat, go back and verify that our own orbit stability requirement has been met. So it's a roundabout way of getting confidence in the model so that we can then use verification by analysis on the requirement. This shows, again, this engineering development unit, the Pathfinder, shows it up close with applied temperatures that we expect to see at our test in JSC. The test itself is actually going to occur at Johnson Space Flight Center's Chamber A, which is, I believe the entry door alone is 40 feet across. it's a seven-story thermal vac chamber, essentially. And we need that because the distance from the primary to the secondary is 7 meters, 20, you know, so it's well over 20 feet. And we have to have optical test equipment above it. The primary purpose of the Johnson test is to prove that we can align the telescope. But we're self-centered. We only want to talk about the thermal distortion test we're going to do once the optical test is done. This shows, back to the idea that this is the Pathfinder, which is essentially a pretest, also to be done at JSC, which only has the two mirrors on it. But as you can see, we've attached a large number of piston sensors, and it'll allow us to track the motion across the entire backplane as we increase in temperature. Here, that Pathfinder is shown with the secondary mirror support structure attached, and it's actually resting on the structure known as the Hoss. As you can see, it's on six basically very spindly legs to minimize, support it adequately without inducing unnecessary deformations into it, because this is a steel structure, so it's going to deform shape a lot more than this composite backplane is. And then over at the various locations around the corner here, you can see that this structure is actually supported up to the top of the chamber, floats on an isolation system at the top of the, suspended from the top of the chamber, actually creating a significant problem for what I said earlier about making sure your flexible and rigid, your flexible modes are different enough from your rigid body modes. Because as you might guess, when you suspend this roughly 50 feet down from the roof of the chamber, it wants to just sit there and sway. And making sure that that's not a mechanism in your model is a real problem we're fighting. So to conclude, we're going to talk about some Femap-specific benefits that we've gotten on the James Webb to tie it back into the whole idea of the Femap Symposium. We've made extensive use of APIs, and they're really appreciably easier to write in Femap than in all, you know, in some of the competitor products. The displacement results from a massive model can be burdensome, to say the least. So extensive use of APIs has been made to go get the displacements we need to care about and extract them. In dynamics, there's been substantial use of summing strain energy by group to allow us to find out where the high strain energy locations are and stiffen those if we need to raise the modes. The stowed telescope had substantial trouble meeting its minimum frequency requirement for a fair bit of the history of the project, but we're comfortable now in large part because we were able to suggest design changes that stiffened up the critical locations. Emmanuel and everybody who uses any thermal distortion, who does any thermal distortion modeling on this telescope, has to make sure that wherever you have a spring element or a rigid element, it is between exactly coincident grids. So APIs were used to interrogate the model and make sure where you had a spring or a rigid element that those grids were truly coincident to the last decimal place. And an API was helpful in that way. As I said, when we're modeling jitter, we need to export the modal data, basically the critical parts of each mode shape. So those were exported using an API. And the global local modeling I showed earlier was all made possible by the use of APIs. One major efficiency that you run in that we benefited from with this very, very large model was the ability to just attach an OP2 file rather than reading in its results. Our dynamicists are saving about an hour with every motor run, and they make dozens and dozens of them every month. By just attaching the OP2 rather than reading it, that gives you the ability to efficiently work with those very large. Our users also find that the ability to just visualize bar and beam properties without doing the full sort of solid model view of a telescope is really beneficial here, because again, once you start doing anything with these larger models, that tends to bog down. And our analysts also love the dongle-based licensing, so that they, when they're working off-net, they can still have access to Femap and be able to do what they need to do. In conclusion, JWST is making excellent strides and will almost certainly meet its 2018 launch date. And Femap has been a big part of why we've been able to do that, and hopefully we will successfully observe the first light of the universe. But we have a lot of analysis to do, and Femap will be a big part of that as well. Thank you for your time.